Okay, jumping right into it. Another Reference Wednesday. We got 600 and more clothing textures in motion. A lot of really cool shots and a bonus pack that comes with it. A lot of really cool images, poses, flow, dynamics, weapons, kind of really cool stances. High resolution as usual. Very cool. And some with the compositional elements in the background. Very cool. It's a nice horizontal diagonal situation going on there. Can imagine some really cool paintings and illustrations with these. And some more portrait-esque shots with some foreshortening of the hands here. Cool. Moving on. So instead of doing what we normally do on Reference Wednesday where we load up the gesture drawing thing, what I'm going to do is just kind of draw only one of them, one of the reference pictures, and see what we can do with that. Potentially make a painting. All right. Anyway, new layer. This is 8.5 by 11, 300 dpi. I'm using Pure Ref. It's a free download. New layer, it's gonna use a round brush at full black. I'm gonna zoom out a little bit and do a quick rough of the pose. Normally I'm doing those triangles and finding shapes. I'm gonna do a little bit of that, but also just a bit of construction this time. So collarbone, sternum, yes. Rib cage, got the shoulder here. It's higher than this shoulder. And we're gonna place the head in real quick right there. The elbow's here. And the hand goes up. And it's lower than the chin, or the wrist is lower than the chin. So I'm gonna make sure that the wrist stays below that line. Okay. It's gonna make a basic stick figure. Here, I am gonna use that negative space of the triangle between the hand and the elbow. Okay. And this hand is aligned with that elbow. And once we have a skeleton structure here, we're going to use that to sketch over all the details and designs. I want to see where the top of the head is. If I look at where the fingertip is, and it's about an angle that fits a equilateral triangle like this. And by that, I mean it kind of feels like an equal triangle there. Let's go back to construction mode. All right. So if that's the rib cage, we're gonna get the spine in, kind of like that. Not sure what the hips will be doing here. Let's see. That must be a knee. And then now the leg must be back there. Or yeah, that seems to be what we're gonna go with. So it's an indication of the hips. And the legs. Trying to use our imagination and figure out where the rest of the body might be. We're not going to be drawing that part, but it helps me get a feel for the stance to know where the legs are. At least where they would be in order for it to make sense in terms of the weight balance. Alright, I got that belt area. Okay, got a triangle there. I should zoom back out. So I'm not being too accurate. What I have in mind is I want to kind of lay things down. I was trying to say out or down at the same time. I can lay things down and then potentially design on top of it to make more of an illustration piece. I'm going to scribble in approximately where the facial features are going to be. We could stylize if we so choose later on. Yeah, it's good enough for me. All right, let's go ahead and make that bigger. Very loose, very nonsensical. Gonna put her a little bit to the left. Just to avoid putting the head directly in the center. The opacity and do a still loose but a little bit more of an accurate pass at the details. So still using the round brush for now. Noticing that there's the frontalis bone, so that's the forehead here, has a really nice indicator of how it transitions to the cheekbone over here. There's a lot of really nice subtlety of the forms here, where the light and shadow are kind of having a dance between subtlety and edges, as well as kind of like lost edges and blurred planes. When I'm placing the rest of the facial features, like the nostrils and eventually the corner of the mouth, and then, you know, the tear ducts and the edge of the eye, I get the question a lot of how do you get likeness. If you can get those in the right place in terms of the relationship between those landmarks, everything else should start to fall into place. So if I put these nostrils too far this way, it doesn't read as it does in the photo. The photo, the nostril is not directly below the tear duct, but it's just off to the right. So if this would be directly below it, it's off to the right over here. Then the question is, how far down do I go? And that's what you have to practice for likeness. It's like, can you fit, I don't know how to explain it except to practice a lot, but is it too high if it's up there? Obviously. Is it way too low if you put the nostril down here? Obviously. And then somewhere in between will feel just right for this likeness. And the next shape we're going to look for is the corner of the mouth. And if we do the whole like typical, you know, subdivisions and the thirds, and like you make sure the mouth is kind of doing, like, you could do that and things could work out, but if you're trying to get likeness, you'll have to figure out exactly the ratio, and then you could push the ratio, but if you look at the nostril and the angle is about 45 degrees, right, and it's like, where do you stop? Well, if you look at where the edge of the eye is and see what that angle gives us, it's about something like that. So we could say that the corner of the mouth is actually about right there, I'm gonna guess. And then this corner of the mouth is like directly below that nostril. Then off to the right a little bit. All right. So that kind of careful measuring and subtlety of looking at these angles, is it 45? Is it past 45 or less? By practicing that, your ability for likeness will greatly improve. Because if you take those proportions and put them on anything, it'll look like this person. That's how those, I think, face apps work. It kind of maps those onto like a 3D face. And caricature artists also take those same proportions and like really push them out. But they still maintain a certain relationship just enough so it still looks like the person. Now, I am going to be pushing these proportions, so it's a little bit stylized. And then let's find out where that cheekbone is. So you can kind of fit a triangle in here in terms of nostril to tear duct to the apex of that cheekbone there. And that's as far as it goes out there. And it's past the edge of this eye. And so we're gonna just do not a vertical straight line here, but a vertical line slightly slanted to the left. And this is just the first pass of detail. I think I made the eyes too close together, but that's fine. We can change that. I'm gonna rotate this a little bit. Okay, so I could try to be accurate with this, and if I wanted to, with that hair strand, I could see where these peaks line up. So the first peak going out is if you take the line from the eyebrow and keep going, it's right there. The next one is about where this eye is, and then the next one is just below the nose, so let's kind of make a line below the nose, and it's further out this way. It's past this one. All right, so these are the kind of things to look for when you're trying to be accurate. It's the apexes of things and how they relate to each other, like constellations of stars. Okay, the next one is directly below the first one. So if we just make a straight line down, but how far is it? And we can kind of just triangulate from the first one, the tear duct, and that angle feels deeper than 45. So it's gonna be probably just something like that, right? And once we have those points, we can kind of just lay in a spiral. And there's another one inside. But I'm not going to try to be too accurate with that. At least not as accurate. Yeah. And let's just let it come together as we go. Cool, so let's figure out where this shadow shape is, kind of implying the sternocleidomastoid, at least the edge of it. As it rounds off into the neck, his eye is too low. Sometimes you just notice things are off after you've looked away enough. So I'm just gonna lay that in. So this line points directly up to this eye. It kind of goes up, goes through the mouth, sort of taps the nostril, and then hits the eye. So if we make a new layer, start at the eye, and sort of spear down through like that. It kind of tells us where that neckline is. All this stuff over here is in shadow, and if I'm planning to paint this, I'm not going to treat it with too much accuracy. Because if something is in the light, I'm going to try to figure out where things are and relationship to each other. But if all of this is in shadow, I know that as a painter, I'm going to probably just indicate all that stuff in the shadow without too much detail later on. Okay, so here, I'm not going to try to be too accurate with the folds there, but I do know that it's going to be a nice kind of scribbling thing. So what I mean by that is, if I was to just do a scribble like this, right, these are all too even, they're all at the same height, and there's nothing interesting happening. However, if I do a scribble like this and vary things, we can find more interesting shapes. Not that it's what I'm going to do exactly, but it's as though I'm going to have an anchor point here, and I'm going to let it fan out from there with varying sizes and shapes and peaks and valleys and stuff. So something like that. While kind of loosely looking at the reference, seeing where like the negative space is like that. And the reason I do that is to kind of maintain a bit of energy. Because if I sat there and I did the points and like I measured exactly where each little thing was, I feel like it loses the fun for me. But hey, if that's what you like doing, then totally go for it. At this point, I want to just skip over to the hands because I just thought they were such cool hand poses. It's kind of blurry. And with the hand, I actually like to just do it separately and then move it onto the piece. We are digital artists here for this process, so we can take advantage of things like that. If I was doing this traditionally, I'd probably have to sit there and measure as we did up here and make sure things are accurate. But I'm just gonna look for the easiest shape. There's a nice little C shape there, or backward C. So I'm gonna start off with that and then build from there. What I like to do for the fingernails is kind of extend them out a little bit like it's a little claw, nice little illustrative thing there. You can fill that in if you want. And even the shadow shapes on the core shadows have their nice shape designed edges and flow and peaks and stuff. I will always forever recommend doing a nice hand challenge, like 500 hands in a week. I do have a video of that. I learned so much from it, all these subtleties of the relationship between finger sizes and knuckles and how to simplify them. Because after you draw something so many times, you find shortcuts that you notice that you can start doing. We'll take that. Oh, wrong layer. Now it's obviously foreshortened, so it's going to be a little bit bigger. Now let's put that back into the spot where it needs to be. All right, but what I have here is a little bit too big. Let's make it a little bit smaller and match with the drawing that we have underneath. And I definitely spend the most time with the hands and the faces. Everything else can be sort of scribbled in, especially in the planning phase. If I what am I saying? Because the setup for the hands and the head and the face are pretty important. Everything else you can kind of figure out later on and kind of even just change if you want. Yeah, the hand's definitely still too big and it's too far to the right. But you know what? I'm going to keep it there. I think it's perfectly fine. That's exaggerated a bit. I take that back. I want it closer. Let's just jump down to this hand. All right, very easy shape here. It's just a kind of curve. I love that kind of palm where the thumb is resting. That shape, it's like a nice, I don't know, lump of clay that you can kind of mold into something. The thing with hands is that there's so many angles and combinations of like gestures and clenched fists or stuff like this, is that each position introduces new shapes that you might not have drawn before, which is why it's such a challenge to get hands to look good from so many different angles. That's why I think developing the ability to kind of interpret on the spot based on many, many iterations of practice is really necessary if that's something you want to be good at. You know, if you're just trying to do, you know, concept art or something, you don't really need to focus on this kind of thing. Because you could just use a 3D model or ZBrush or something. Because for concept art, it doesn't matter how you illustrate things. It's just about getting the idea or the concept across. This is more of a illustration or artistic kind of academic approach of, hey, I want to learn the measurements and the subtleties of the angles of the knuckles and fingers and stuff. And how the light kind of falls onto the forms. That stuff isn't as useful for concept. It's definitely useful, like if you can be good at this and idea generation, you're that much more valuable if you had to kind of just sketch something quickly, but again, it's not super necessary. All right, gonna compare the size of the hands here. And this one's a little bit further back in space, so I'm gonna make it a little smaller. I'm going to see where the wrist here is going to intersect with the hand. While I do have this drawn there, I don't have to follow that. And if I look at where the arm and wrist are actually aligning with the fingers, it's right in between the pointer finger and the middle finger there. It's a little bump of the, I believe, the ulna, which is the bone. So before I lay in these loose lines of the clothing, I'm going to put in landmark things first. So that belt thing, I don't even know what it's called. I'm going to put that first as a sort of kind of anchor. I think the hand is a little still too big. But it takes on a bit of a cylindrical form. And I think the solidity of that can kind of help anchor down all these lines I'm about to put in of the cloth. Now this one I am actually making this a little bit accurate. You can see there's a sort of letter N. It goes from here, there, and there. So if we kind of use that as our guide, it's a big N. And then it keeps going, kind of like a zigzag. Okay. His hand is still too big. So there's like some really cool patterns going on in here. Whenever I see that, I could, you know, make the choice of making it accurate in terms of, oh, there's a triangle in there, there's some graphic elements. But what I like to do at the opportunity is kind of introduce my own shapes. And I think it's a good idea for each artist to take it upon themselves to kind of come up with a library of internal patterns of, like, I like to do this kind of overlap, and then again, and then maybe draw shapes between. But yeah, kind of like finding and studying different patterns that exist, whether it's from Victorian fashion back in the day, or Middle Eastern, or something completely different, like patterns in nature. So I would say do that. And it's definitely a shape design exercise. To make sure that looks decent. Now I'm gonna flip it, and I know this always happens. I'm probably gonna regret it because I'm gonna notice a bunch of asymmetries and weird things. Not too bad, actually. Now I see that the hand is too big in the foreground compared to the head, and instead of making the hand smaller, I'm gonna make the head bigger. Yeah, it feels a bit more correct. Cool, now we have all the information we need to kind of make a quick painting. So I'm gonna make all this bigger, somewhat match the composition in the photo, but more to the left. Now I'm noticing that this elbow has a really nice statement of being pushed out to the right there, and I feel like I'm missing that here, so I'm gonna just put in a nice little reminder to kind of push that out like that a little bit more. Okay, and that background of the zigzagging red, I'm just gonna lay that in as a guide. Cool. Maybe some nice squigglies in there. All right, so I'm gonna grab a new layer underneath everything. Just grab any color. That red's fine. And I'm going to zoom out on both of these. And just only be concerned with the values. I'm not too focused at all with the colors just yet. Just want to get the contrast to work to where I want it to be. So I put in that 50%-ish red. So it's about halfway. And I'm going to work from there. I might eyeball some of the colors, but I just want to block in the basics. I'm blurring my eyes. If you can't blur your eyes at will, you could also squint, and your eyelashes will kind of simplify the reference. Okay. Once it feels like it's almost like reading as finished when it's zoomed out like this, if we kind of compare the two. You know, they're both believable. You know, one is obviously a photo, so it's a different look in terms of content. But then I'll zoom in a little bit more until it no longer feels finished, and then pursue a bit more accuracy here. And I'm not going to zoom in right away and start rendering. I'm going to slowly creep into it as a painting and build up. At this point, I'll probably be pretty quiet. I'm just kind of letting myself get into the zone, ping-ponging my eyes back and forth, seeing what needs to be edited or which values need to be pushed or pulled, and that sort of thing. It's okay if it takes a long time. There's no rush. To make a new layer and paint on top of things. Like this whole area is pretty overexposed and light, whereas in mine it's there's that black color, so I'm gonna just get in some of that salmon and just paint it in on this whole area. I could bring those highlights back out in a moment. Or I could just set it to lighten, but it's fine. for fun, I'm just gonna merge that all together. Now at this point, I will zoom in and start painting the face. That is the most fun part for me. I usually don't wait 45 minutes to start painting the face, but it's rewarding if you have everything else set up.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, we can call that just done for now. Oh, really dived in there. Had some fun with the folds and details. And obviously if you zoom in, it's all a total mess. But, you know, you zoom out, kind of feels pretty good. Definitely took some liberties, added some tattoos, changed the pattern design on some of the clothing, and we added this little glowy thing. All right, hope that was helpful to kind of watch. Be sure to check out the links in the description for this pack and use the code Ahmedalduri, Ahmedalduri, for a discount on the reference packs. All right, I will see you next time.